Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is J.R. Moore coming to you live from deep in the mountains of the Missouri Ozarks. On Monday, the 20th day of January, year of our Lord, 2014, welcome to the John Moore Show. Well, ladies and gentlemen, today is going to be one of the more important shows I've done in my radio career, which spans, 19 years. We're having Mr. Dave Hodges. Dave, are you there, sir?
I am here, and we're all going to be on patrol in the near future. And let me tell you where I think this is going, John, and we'd be remiss if we didn't talk about what was going on with the chilly relationship between the Obama administration and our present military. The military, in large part, is not on board with this administration, which is why Obama has found it necessary to fire about 250, actually it's going on 260 now, senior-level military officers from all branches who are not going along with his intention to create a series of false flag attacks, followed by the imposition of martial law spearheaded by Russian and Chinese troops and other blue-helmeted UN troops on this soil. And then he'll take us into the Third World War once this country is fully subjugated. That's what's coming. That's what the military is resisting. And I believe that, as Jim Garrow says, former ex-CIA agent that I had on my show last month, we are headed for a civil war. And it's not going to be what Dave and John say on the air. It's going to be what the military is going to do. But see, Yuri Bezmenov said this is what would happen. He said that the United States is following KGB's subversive tactics through control of the media, and they will ignore everything that's going on until it's too late. And I'm here to tell you right now, it's almost too late. Well, you're right, and what you're referring to with that conflict going back into the Clinton years, we also saw a practice ground for gun confiscation. Door-to-door gun confiscations went on in this country, on that country, under the auspices of the United Nations.
Absolutely. My friend Command Sergeant Major Page was a liaison between the Russian Spetsnaz in Bosnia and our people. And once these Spetsnaz got a few vodkas in them, they thought it was just so funny and laughed, belly laughed, about what they were doing in Bosnia, going door-to-door, getting firearms, was practice for what they'd be doing in America. In fact, Dave, they trained with and had American uniforms, and they spoke English with the Johnny Carson Nebraska neutral accent, and were quite proud and thought it was so funny of what they were doing in Bosnia would be practice for what they'd be doing in America, collecting firearms door to door.
Well, this is, you know, what I hear from people in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, is that these Russians as an immigrant group, they're very self-contained. They don't communicate with people other than their own. They're standoffish and arrogant in public. But to a person, they speak perfect English. Now, show me an immigrant group in mass that speaks perfect accent-neutral English. That doesn't exist. These people have been trained for decades to do what
Dave,
they're doing.
A friend of mine, he escaped from the Czechoslovakia in the 1980s before the wall came down. And he is a Czech language, is a Slavic language, just like Russian. And I asked my friend Joe, I said, Joe, what does it take to take a native-born Slavic-speaking person to speak neutral, accent-free, neutral English, the Johnny Carson Nebraska accent, as I sometimes say. And he says, John, there's only one way. You start teaching them when they're 5 years old.
Exactly.
There is no other way. There is no other way.
Yeah, the research shows linguistically that if you don't teach a foreign language to a child before the age of 8, they will always have an accent.
And that's very true. So here's what happens, Dave. The representatives of Spetsnaz go into Russian kindergartens. They do diagnostic testing. You're a psychologist. You know this. They figure out who's really bright, has a near genius level IQ, who's very athletic, and 13 years in the future, which 5-year-olds will be very bright, very athletic, and think it's perfectly normal to jump out of airplanes in the middle of the night and kill people. They take them out of these Russian kindergartens, they put them in the Spetsnaz kindergartens, and start teaching them English and training them when they're beginning at 5 years old, Dave. That's what they do.
Well, a lot of these have been here for a long time, and just in the form of sleeper agents. We've learned that from the Russian defectors.
Absolutely.
But now we're seeing entire military units that are here, and they are training. And what I've been told in Victorville, I know a man who gets on the base, and I'm not going to reveal his business, but he actually gets to see things. They search his cell phone, they search him before he leaves, and he's not the only contractor, so I can reveal this part. He says that he sees these Russians training in their tanks and their heavy armored vehicles with blue helmeted Americans in uniform, but they're wearing blue helmets of the UN.
Well, that gives me a warm, fuzzy feeling. Dave, we got a stack of calls here. We need to start getting into these phone calls. First, we go to Glenn in Philadelphia. Good morning, Glenn.
Good morning, John. Good morning, Dave.
Good morning.
Oh, I see this glaring contradiction between this supposedly oppositional approach we see of Putin towards the Obama administration, and we see Putin credited with backing off the Syria attack, when we also know that General Dempsey went up in the middle of the night to the White House to tell Obama that, you know, came not to go forward with the Syria attack. Like, it seems as though the major media sells us that we're really still in Cold War tension with Russia, and yet here somebody is allowing all these troops and all this equipment to come onto our soil. It very much has the appearance of an overarching umbrella of globalist control. What's your take on this?
Well, I think you're absolutely right. It's all theater. I think some of the early forays that we were threatening to go into Syria with and being opposed by Putin was to create the illusion that there's an issue. And let me point to two things which makes me say this. One, we had a drill in November, a two-day drill called GRID X2, and GRID X2 simulated a power takedown drill, which makes it a highly sensitive and secure drill. We allowed the Russians and the Chinese to participate in these drills. And then this year we have what's called the RIMPAC War Games, and it's the largest war games on the planet. And historically it's 12 nations that fight, you know, at least they pretend to be fighting against Russian and Chinese tactics in the Pacific. Only the thing is, this year, the Russians and Chinese are going to be a part of it. So the Obama administration is trying to merge Russian and Chinese military interests in with our own. This is why Obama has to fire so many military officers, because they're not going along with this treason.
Right, right.
They work for the bankers. I mean, let's call it what it is. Obama, and I'll go right on the record and say this, Obama and Putin are working for what I call the bastards from Basel. That's
exactly
who's really behind this.
Exactly. Oh, I love it. Very good. And it's my contention that in this with GRID-X stuff and all these EMP saber rattling we hear in threats, that these guys, you know, just like the neutron bomb takes down people without damaging infrastructure, they don't want to take down infrastructure. I think they're going to flip switches and take things down regionally and then restore the grid. I don't think they want to permanently damage the infrastructure. But, you know, what's your take on that?
Well, I agree. And in fact, maybe this is the time to bring this out. And I've mentioned this on my show from time to time. I used to be a Maricopa County first responder here in the Phoenix area for my campus, because my family would get the drugs first. They came to my campus, asked for volunteers. And then there was a transition period following 9/11 where FEMA basically took over the operation. In that time, I became friends with a man in FEMA whose job was essentially to do counter-bioterrorism for FEMA. And he and I became very close. I've actually taught a couple of his kids who've taken my psychology classes. They've now gone into hiding. I'll finish this on the other side.
Okay, we got a break. We'll finish on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Dave, let's wrap up your comment before we move on to our next call, please.
Right. Sir. In October of 2012, I was visited by this individual that I knew, and he brought his wife with him, who I had known for a number of years. And they told me that they were moving after this individual had retired from FEMA with like-minded FEMA people to the southeastern portion of this country and what they had been preparing in self-contained communities. And I've been able to verify the existence. I've heard from them since they've been there. They're not the only ones who are doing this. Members of DHS are doing this, members of the CIA. It's different locations around the country, but they know what's coming. And let me tell you what they said's coming. One is a power grid takedown. That's going to initiate the entire situation. And what the caller just said about not destroying infrastructure, he is exactly on the money. Now, will the next steps be nuclear or biological or chemical or all? Well, that's really crimes of opportunity that the Obama administration will follow as the situation dictates. The plan really is to create a crisis that ports people into detention centers, into stadiums and malls and so forth that DHS has formed agreements with, and then they're going to get the people where they want them and the fun will begin. And then the stragglers left behind will be gassed and attacked by air from drones. And this was made quite clear, and I've got two inside military sources that tell me that exactly what this FEMA man told me is on the money, And Dr. Jim Garrow, who is now public after 43 years of service in the CIA, came on my show December 22nd and verified every single word I've just said.